In 2016, Paris embarked on a journey to transform its urban landscape into something greener, more functional, and fittingly, more egalitarian. The result of this initiative soon became known as the Grand Paris Express. This transportation marvel has been hailed as the largest civil engineering endeavor in Europe and the construction site of the century. And despite ballooning budgets and waning expectations, the Grand Paris Express may turn one of Europe's oldest capitals into the city of the future. Because this colossal undertaking is not merely a train system, but a transformative leap for urban mobility and sustainable living. Paris is the city of lights, the city of romance, and one of the most important cultural centers in the history of the world. Yet amid floods of tourists, around 44 million of them in 2022 alone, we sometimes forget that people actually live and work here. These men and women are less concerned with the Eiffel Tower, the Louvre, Notre Dame Cathedral, and the Arc de Triomphe. Instead, they want to get where they're going quickly, efficiently, and cheaply. Of course, if the government has anything to say about it, they'd prefer the solution be environmentally friendly. If you break it down into the most basic terms, the Grand Paris Express is really just an extension of the existing Paris metro system. Yet, even if one doesn't consider the massive social, political, and environmental implications, the project is still incredibly ambitious. It aims to more than double the network's reach, adding over 120 miles of new tracks. This expansion not only includes a total of 4 new underground lines, but a whopping 68 freshly constructed metro stations. Will it allow for faster transit time? Of course, but that's hardly scratching the surface of what the Grand Paris Express means to the city and to the rest of the world. At its core, the project seeks to enhance connectivity, bridging the heart of central Paris with its distant suburbs, while also interlinking these suburbs among themselves. If the planners are correct, the network could do so much more than just shorten commutes. It could change the economic and social fabric of the neighborhoods, business districts, and cities, many of which are in dire need of the help. When most people think of Paris, they're thinking of the 105 square kilometers that make up the central city. This area is indeed densely populated and quite crowded. It's not only home to around 2 million people, but it's also the primary destination for many of the millions of tourists who visit the city each month. Still, this isn't all of Paris. The surrounding administrative region, known as Île-de-France region, is home to another 10 million individuals, many of whom need to travel at least twice per day in order to get to work. During the suburban boom of the 60s, 70s, and 80s, the city primarily focused on shuttling commuters into the city center, and rightfully so. However, they did little to nothing to address intra-suburban commutes, which can now take hours and require multiple stops. And with public transit not fulfilling their needs, Île-de-France residents have increasingly turned to cars, which have social, environmental, and aesthetic costs. Therefore, one of the main priorities of the new Grand Paris Express is to improve suburb-to-suburb commutes and regional travel, bypassing central Paris whenever possible to avoid congestion. Of course, there's plenty of inefficiencies within the so-called tourist train routes as well. For instance, the journey from Charles de Gaulle Airport to Versailles, two destinations with obvious appeal to visitors, currently takes around 2 hours and requires several transfers. When the Grand Paris Express is done, analysts hope to see this transform into a 45-minute direct route. That said, the project's not been quick to arrive. In fact, the concept that became the Grand Paris Express evolved from a plan outlined by then-President Nicolas Sarkozy in 2011. At the time, he claimed to envision a city where Paris and its suburbs could be better united, hopefully increasing continuity and solidarity while also allowing for faster transportation. This vision's withstood the test of time. In fact, it survived 3 presidential administrations, more than a decade of planning, and significant delays and budget overruns. The current estimate for the project is 36 billion euros, or just shy of $40 billion. When you look at the projects in terms of some new train lines, that price is almost laughable. But when you see it for its potential to transform Paris as we know it, the investment suddenly becomes worthwhile. Indeed, one of the ways the Grand Paris hopes to completely transform the city is through drastically reduced carbon emissions, by providing a robust, efficient, and comfortable public transportation network. Engineers hope to cut 14.2 million tons of carbon dioxide emissions by 2050. This aligns with France's recent efforts to combat climate change, but will actually rely on incentivizing human behavior rather than attempting to alter it. For the time being, the environment will have to wait, because the construction project currently going on above and beneath the Paris streets is enough to make Boston's famous Big Dig look like a sandcastle. Across hundreds of square kilometers, the country's state-owned infrastructure agency, the Grand Paris Society, has employed a fleet of tunnel boring machines. These massive 100-meter-long machines can not only drill at a pace of 15 meters per day, but can simultaneously lay the reinforced concrete slabs that line the tunnel walls. When finished, these walls should last up to a century without any need for extensive repairs. This is hardly the only innovation that's come out of the project, either. Around the city, engineers are employing various cutting-edge techniques to build the new train lines with minimal surface disruption. One such example is building information modeling, or BIM, which has become a major part of the overall project. The technology uses 3D modeling to guide the excavation and construction process and facilitate better coordination between the various teams spread out across the city. With the BIM, each team can access an ultra-detailed, real-time 3D digital model of the network, which covers around 12,000 square kilometers. Finally, since many of the new lines reach depths of around 30 meters to avoid intersecting with existing infrastructure, they utilize state-of-the-art waterproofing techniques, coatings, and drainage systems to prevent water buildup. Of course, this being France, the 64 new metro stations will be much more than just mere transit points. Each will feature retail spaces, amenities, and unique art installations created specifically for the project. The goal is to create true public spaces rather than just cold concrete platforms for boarding and deboarding. Architect Dominique Perrault remarked of the endeavor, "We're creating the double surface of Paris, a new skeleton for the metropole. In that way, the project's not just about connecting places, but creating new, interactive environments." The fact that each station will function as its own art gallery, retail center, and communal space does nothing to outshine the actual breadth of the engineering. The Grand Paris Express expands the metro network through four new automatically operated lines, 15, 16, 17, and 18, and numerous multi-kilometer extensions of existing lines. So far, the north extension of Line 14 has been completed. It features four new stations and a 5.8-kilometer-long tunnel connecting Saint-Lazare to Marie de Saint-Ouen. Line 15, once completed, will form a 75-kilometer loop around the city, which will subsequently be divided into east, west, and south sections. Each of these will cater to the unique needs of people from those areas, aiming to accommodate at least 2 million individuals per day by 2030. Line 16, which covers 50 kilometers from north to south between Saint-Denis-Pleyel and Noisy-Champs, is intended to improve connectivity between the airport, central Paris, and multiple southern destinations. Meanwhile, Line 17 will connect Charles de Gaulle Airport to the La Défense Business District and the town of Nanterre. Both of these are set to begin operation sometime between 2026 and 2028, as they are, for the time being, enjoying simultaneous construction. Finally, you have Line 18, which will link Versailles to Orly Airport in the south. With its 10 stations and 35 kilometers of above and underground track, it hopes to open between 2027 and 2030. Still, any project this large and this expensive will come with its fair share of critics. Even the architects and Sarkozy himself acknowledge the politics inherent in the project, which will undoubtedly provide a lot of relief and mobility to lower-income individuals. With just one ticket, passengers will be able to flow from the metro to buses and trains, breaking down many of the cultural and economic barriers dividing the different parts of Île-de-France. Those who see the world in terms of fences and borders may not be quite so thrilled about that development. The cost and the mounting setbacks have also been a point of contention. Indeed, the Grand Paris Express was originally planned to be operational in time for the 2024 Paris Summer Olympics, a goal that'll be missed by a large margin. Many Parisians have expressed frustration about the setbacks, especially those whose livelihoods depend on the daily influx of people to and from various parts of the city. Clearly, the Grand Express developers see it as much more than just another transit project. It'll thrust Paris and its population into the future, break down economic and cultural barriers, and drastically reduce carbon emissions in a region of more than 12 million people. The question for now is whether or not the people of Paris will embrace these changes with as much gusto as the politicians and engineers expect them to. What do you think? Leave your thoughts about the Grand Paris Express in the comments below, and make sure to like and subscribe to Futurescapes. Thanks for tuning in.